Welcome to our presentation, Living in a Material World, Specifying Shade Fabrics to Meet Occupant Needs, sponsored by CEDIA. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Margaret Block, and I'm the product manager for luxury residential shades at Lupon.
My name is Catherine Chiarelli, and I'm our residential shade sales leader at Lupon. Let's get started. This presentation is qualified with both AIA and IDCEC. At the end of this presentation, we hope you guys are armed to be able to select roller shade fabrics for specific areas of the home based on your client's needs, to understand how color, structure, and weave of a shade fabric can affect the light coming in, to identify the right amount of fabric opacity, and to understand how a material affects the shade's ability to protect your furniture and finishings from UV. So today we're going to be talking about roller shades. Now, when we're using roller shades, typically we're even considering this option because of a functional need. So we're either looking to keep out sunlight to reduce heat or protect furnishings, to darken the room for sleeping or for a better TV viewing experience, or to create a safe private space for our clients. Now, when we automate, we can capitalize on a range of possible benefits. So let's start with comfort and convenience. We can make sure our window treatments are open to let the sunlight in when we're home, but always closed when we're away or during the times of harshest sun in each day. Tall and hard to reach windows, as well as any environment with multiple windows next to one another, will benefit from automation, because without it, you likely won't move those shades very often. And of course, smooth and silent movement is now achievable with automated shades. Now, how about aesthetics? So when we have a number of windows, like you see here, we can ensure that those shades are always perfectly aligned when they're still and even when they're in motion. There are no cords or chains dangling in between each window. And a major part of the magic, when those shades are open, they can either disappear completely into a pocket or stay exposed to highlight really beautiful hardware. So let's start by talking about these automated control options. Wall controls allow you to operate shades with the quick push of a button, whether you live there or you're just a guest visiting the home. These can be low voltage controls like you see here, or something as simple as a battery-powered remote. It's so easy now to use apps on your phone or tablet to move your shades, no matter where you are in the world. You can also set up specific things to happen at certain times. So if your kids are sleeping in, schedule the shades to raise at 7 a.m. If you have crazy sun that starts at noon, let's schedule those shades to lower every day to protect your home from UV. And now you can control it all without touching a thing by simply using voice control. And of course, manual control is an option. Here's what we know about studies on shade control. Manual shades are basically never moved and they're often down. So all of a sudden, that beautiful view that's the perfect backdrop, perhaps even the inspiration for your design of their home, it's gone. Now, let's put views alone aside for a moment. We spend most of our time indoors, and a lot of that is in our home. When we talk about designing with well-being in mind, we know we need to bring the outside in. Countless studies over the years have indicated that natural light can improve mood and sleep patterns. From a well-being perspective, it's important to consider how massive a positive impact automated shades can have on the client.
Now, a large part of selecting the right shade fabric is aesthetics, but let's put that aside for just a moment and identify some of the top qualities of the space that we need to know in order to make the right technical fabric recommendation. So the first thing to think about is, where are these shades, right? The orientation of the window will tell us how much sun to expect. For example, southern facades tend to receive full sun for much of the day. Surrounding conditions outside the window are even more important. So if our southern facing window looks out onto a building just a few feet away, we won't be receiving that full sun after all. Nearby bodies of water, reflective buildings may introduce other direct light from an unexpected direction. Another thing to think about is, what are the performance needs for the shade, right? So of course, the design team, you're gonna have color, texture requirements that fit your project plan. But we also have to take into account color requirements that are set by the building or even a homeowners association, right, where the project is located. So historically, these groups have required white-backed shade fabrics, but more increasingly, we're seeing demand for gray-backed fabrics or charcoal-backed fabrics that blend very seamlessly with the tint of low-E glass. And a main motivation for automated shading is to reduce heat gain. So different fabrics vary in thermal performance, and we'll talk about that a little bit. We might also be using shades to reduce reverberation in a space and increase that acoustic performance. And last, what does the client actually want these shades to do? So they may want to allow a particular amount of light to come through that fabric. They may also work from home or be avid sports fans, in which case reducing glare on the television screens and computer monitors is a top priority. And many clients have fantastic views that they want to preserve. So we want to make sure we're taking all of this into account before we select fabric to use on our automated shades. So once we know what we want, we can assess each of our fabric options for these qualities. And this is how we're going to determine what kind of fabric and what fabric properties are perfect for us. We'll go through each one of these one by one. So first of all, fabric characteristics. Let's talk a little bit about openness factor. So you may actually be familiar with this term, right? This essentially describes how much of a fabric is made up of holes. So if we take a look at these three pictures, right, a 0% openness factor would have 0% holes. So this is what we call a blackout fabric. So no light is coming through the fabric itself. So now as the number gets higher, the fabric gets more sheer. So it can go up to about 10% with most performance fabrics. And with a lot of decorative shears, you'll see openness factors even higher than that. Now let's take a look at color. So color is very important to the design. And that's all, you know, we as the client, the architect designer, that's what we want to focus on. But how does color of the fabric actually impact the performance? So light-colored fabrics are very traditional for roller shades, right? They provide the benefit of reflecting heat to keep your space cool. They also bring light into the space. So if your space is very bright already, this can create tremendous glare and may obscure your view through the fabric. A dark-colored fabric tends to preserve your view a little bit better. So think about standard window screens, you know, tinted car windows, and even sunglasses, right? You tend to also see with darker fabrics that dark fabrics tend to absorb heat a little more and may even feel hot to the touch occasionally. So here's a really good example. If you take a look at the picture on the left and the picture on the right, what you're seeing here is the difference in view through the dark fabric versus through the lighter fabric. So for each of these images, you're looking at the exact same fabric, just in different openness factors. So from left to right in both of these pictures, we have a 10% openness, 5%, 3%, and then 1%. And these photos were taken just moments apart, so we can see how much clearer the view is through those dark fabrics on the left. We also get a different feel from each of these images, right? The dark fabric may look a little more sleek and modern, whereas the white fabric tends to have a more traditional blended view in this room that has a lot of light colors and neutrals. Now, this fabric we're using here is actually what we'd call a twill weave, which creates a dual-sided effect with a white backing. So this helps reflect more heat back outside and also contributes to privacy while allowing us to choose our desired aesthetic and performance for the interior color. So what that means is that dark fabric that you see on the left actually has a white-colored backing on the outside, giving us those added performance benefits. And we'll talk about some of these elements in a few minutes. Now let's take a look at fabric weave, right? The weave of a fabric describes how the strands are connected together. This has a huge impact on the performance and aesthetic of the material itself. So there are three common fabric weaves that we see in most roller shade fabrics: basket weave, twill, and knits. And we'll go through each one of these. So a basket weave offers structural stability and can often be railroaded, so you can make wider shades. It's typically described by the number of strands running vertically and horizontally in the pattern. So many basket weaves actually are symmetrical, with a 1x1 or a 2x2 weave. This graphic here on the left shows a 2x2. Symmetrical basket weaves will offer the clearest view through, while asymmetrical basket weaves have a little bit more of a decorative aesthetic. So an asymmetric weave might be a 1x2 weave. Twill uses different colored fibers to create a dual-sided sheer effect, much like the dark fabric we saw in that previous picture, where more of one color is on the front versus the back. So the weave tends to look more diagonal or even a diamond shape. You can have many other decorative shapes using a twill weave as well. So using twill actually allows for this two-sided effect without having to coat the back of the material in any sort of metal material. So when would we be interested in this two-sided effect? So you may have a building or HOA that requires a white-backed or a dark-backed fabric facing the street. You may have a space where you want a uniform aesthetic from the outside, but you want to change up what fabric aesthetic you have on the inside of the room. So that's a great opportunity to use a twill fabric. You might also have some rooms where you have really high heat, direct sunlight, and that drives the specification for a white-backed fabric to help with some of that heat. And last, we have the knits. So knit fabrics are typically knit together instead of woven, kind of like a sweater. So these fabrics are highly decorative, right? They're very delicate, unlikely to be railroadable, but they do give you more of a softer hand and a soft fabric effect. Now let's take a look at fabric composition, right? Fabric composition describes what the actual strands are made out of. So first we have what we call a fiberglass core fabric. So it's a very common option. Fiberglass is fantastic at holding its shape without sagging. So this is why you'll notice that some of the only fabrics that we use to make a tension shade, like something that we put into a skylight application, has a fiberglass core. So it's very lightweight, it has a very thin strand, and it's also inherently fire resistant. One of the biggest things to be aware of with fiberglass is that, just like a piece of paper, if it gets wrinkled, these creases tend to be pretty difficult to get out, right? Now, on the other hand, you have a polyester core fabric. So these fabrics tend to be very flexible and wrinkles can relax out more easily. One important thing to note, though, is that these fabrics are more quickly influenced by very, very intense heat, and we'll take a look at what that means. So here is a very exaggerated visual of how these different fabrics perform under very high heat. So you can see that the polyester core material tends to deform just a tad. So this is exactly why we insist that fiberglass core fabrics are used for tension shades, which, like I said, are often installed in skylights, which are subject to pretty high heat. So of course, these specific shades were tested to ultra extreme temperatures, but we can still expect a little more deformation to happen with the polyester core versus fiberglass. Now, as I mentioned a little earlier, the fiberglass core, the yarns itself tend to be a little more slender than the polyester core. So this visual kind of demonstrates why you might think that's important. So these two fabrics pieces side by side have the exact same openness factor, right? So there's the same number of open space in both of these square inches of fabric. But how that open space is actually distributed can make a big difference on the end effect. So the fiberglass core fabric on the left tends to have smaller strand widths, which means that there's more holes in a given area. So this can lead to better visibility because our brain can more easily kind of connect the dots so we can recognize the shape of the letter you see here through the strands. Now on the right, you have larger strands, and the width of that necessitates fewer holes in a given area. So we may have worse view through. We can still tell what the letter is, but we can't really see all of the detail. So when you have this on a bigger window, this may be something that may be visible. So let's pause for a second and ask ourselves a quick question. So if you need a shade for a window, the window is very large, what fabric composition might you look for? So lots of variables to consider here, but we tend to look at fiberglass core fabrics because they tend to be better for suitability for larger shades. Now, certainly, you really have to take into account a lot of different variables, and there's no guarantee, but certainly looking out for fiberglass core fabrics could help. Now, let's take a look at acoustic performance. So when we talk about acoustic performance for roller shades, we aren't talking about keeping the sound out. So if you want to keep street noises out of your home, you're looking to add mass, right, to prevent sound from traveling. Think about draperies or Roman shades, right? Right now, we're going to talk about how roller shades and the fabric you select for that shade can actually have an effect on keeping some of the sound in and designated to certain parts of your house. So when we're looking for acoustic performance with a solar shade, we're discussing how a shade can stop sound from bouncing around within a space. So this is a really important element in any environment where we have conference calling technology or listening to music in these spaces. Maybe you have building and construction materials in that room that make sounds very live, right? Maybe a lot of concrete, lots of marble. So both the density and the thickness of the fabric selected for your roller shade will affect how much that fabric can absorb sound. So how do we know? What do we look for? Well, we look at the measured NRC value, okay? NRC stands for noise reduction coefficient. And an NRC of zero would be kind of like a wall or just a window, just a pane of glass, where it reflects all of the sound back. So an NRC of one would be perfectly absorptive. So we're looking for fabrics with an NRC of 0.5 or greater if we really want to make an impact on the sound in that space. So something to think about here, what openness factor is likely to have the highest NRC value? So surprisingly, you might have thought, blackout fabrics would be the answer to this, but blackout fabrics aren't very good because they kind of act like a wall or a piece of glass, right? The sound bounces right back. So we want a material with a high NRC rating. Remember, that's noise reduction coefficient. And the higher the value, the more this fabric can help to dampen sound from bouncing around. So we're actually going to see that the best NRC ratings typically come from a 1% fabric. But we do always want to look at the technical data provided by the fabric mill to get the real metric for each option that we're considering. One other thing to really keep in mind when we're looking at acoustic performance is the material of the fabric itself, right? And also the sound that it might make as it moves up and down, right? So if you are considering this, consider using a flock-backed blackout option for very silent movement. So what does that mean? What is flocking? So blackout fabrics tend to have an extra layer that makes them dense and helps prevent light from going through. So flocked fabrics are created by spraying an adhesive on the back and then shooting tiny cottony fibers at that adhesive. So the fibers tend to stick to the fabric and causes fuzzy coating, right? So why is flocking a good choice? So this fuzzy backing can help dissipate some of that electrostatic energy that tends to accumulate as the shade fabric moves against itself. The static can sometimes cause a sticky sound when it moves, and flocked backings actually help to reduce that sound pretty well. So if you have rooms like a nursery, you have rooms where you're wanting to keep that sound out, certainly using a flocked backing will help.
All right, let's talk about heat and UV. Now, for maximum heat and UV protection, of course, the answer is lower luminous factors, ideally a blackout fabric. But it's not always possible to have dual rollers. And many clients will be unhappy if their only layer of window treatments are blackouts. And especially in a living space, I really don't like to use just a blackout in a living room because people tend to not like to have that down. So knowing that, how can we make the right choices to reduce heat gain and UV damage? First, it is important to understand that heat and UV must be treated differently. So think of it this way. Heat and UV are on opposite ends of the visible light spectrum. You can sit near a campfire and you feel heat on your legs, your skin feels warm, but you'll realize you didn't get a tan, right? Or you could be out skiing and you're freezing cold, right? In the snow, and you end up with a sunburn because that's UV damage. So it makes sense that we might need to choose a different shade fabric to keep heat out versus protecting from UV. So this means that we actually need to determine with the client which one is our priority. And that's true across the board with choosing shade fabrics. Figuring out our main priorities is the most important part. So we may want to choose heat gain as our top priority if our space gets uncomfortably warm and our HVAC system cannot keep it comfortable in there. Or if energy savings is our goal, keeping heat out will reduce our air conditioning costs in the summer. And we'll do this by reflecting as much light back outside as possible. Now, on the other hand, if we have a ton of valuable artwork or furniture in the space or beautifully finished hardwood floors, we may want to prioritize reducing UV damage, which we would do by reducing the amount of solar energy that can travel through the fabric. So for heat, you're going to want to use a white-backed fabric. This is because that white fabric won't absorb the heat. It will reflect it away back outside the glass. This is represented on this image here by RS, solar reflectance. Now, silver-backed fabrics also have a high solar reflectance, or RS value. For UV, you actually want to specify a dark fabric. This is so counterintuitive, I know, but dark fabrics have a lower TS, or solar transmittance, which means that's how much solar energy comes through, including UV. So this is because those dark strands have a higher solar absorbance, and they're going to grab onto the UV and won't let it bounce into the room. So you'll pretty quickly realize that there's a conflict between reduced heat, lighter colors are better, and reduced solar energy, darker colors are better. This is why it's so important to talk to the client about their main goals for the space. Now, of course, if the shades never come down, it doesn't really matter what fabric they're made of, right? So make sure to set schedules that bring those shades down automatically at the times of day where we have the most sunlight coming in. So let's think for a second. If we have a space with really valuable artwork, what fabric properties should we look for? Now the answer here is both. We want to look for a fabric that's darker colored so that it snags onto those UV light rays and doesn't let them through, and also a fabric with a lower openness factor, so there's fewer holes overall. Now this one, there's a little bit of opinion here, but what fabric composition could be a really good choice for a facade with gorgeous views of the ocean and lots of direct sunlight? A twill weave can be a really nice option when we have a great view, so we want to preserve our view out, but we also could have a lot of heat coming in. So a twill weave fabric that has a ochre color on the room side will preserve our view, and the lighter color on the exterior side will reflect more of that heat back out. Okay, how about humid environments? Now, just to start, of course, nobody recommends installing an automated shade in a shower. Wet environments are not ideal for anything automated or honestly made of fabric. There are tons of humid locations within a bathroom, for example, require privacy. We may also see high humidity in spaces with indoor pools. So our concern here is, when the environment is fine for the electronic components, how can we choose a fabric that will perform best? Now, you see this little logo on the bottom left of your screen. That's the American Society of Testing and Materials. And they have a specific standard regarding what can be called an antimicrobial fabric. So you'll want to select a material that's been ASTM rated as antimicrobial for these humid environments. These fabrics inhibit the growth of bacteria, mold, and mildew that can cause stains, odors, and actually degrade the fabric over time. Okay, privacy. Privacy is one of the main reasons people use window treatments. The thing about privacy is that it is incredibly subjective. What one person considers adequate can be totally unacceptable to another. So I like to think of this, you know, when meeting a new client, it's similar to the wide range of comfort levels people have about posting personal information and photos on social media, right? So some folks are happy to share details about their life and their family and their day-to-day, and some people don't even want their friends wishing them a happy birthday online. And it's exactly the same with privacy in our own homes. So what you see here is the visibility through what we would call a less than 1% fabric or translucent fabric at night. Now remember, that openness factor, 0% is a blackout. So if something is between 0 and 1%, it's not quite as sheer, and we would call it translucent. A lot of times people will call this a privacy fabric. Now let's take a look at this image. On the left, we can see a person standing on a second story of their home. They're standing immediately in front of the window, adjacent to the fabric. We can tell it's an adult. Maybe we might think it might be a man. Now, if we look at the middle picture where he steps 1 foot back, it's harder to discern what that shape is, right? Maybe we can tell it's a person. And on the right-hand side, when he's standing 2 feet away from the fabric, it's almost impossible to tell what's causing that faint shadow. So this is one of the reasons that it is so hard to quantify privacy. We get that question a lot from clients, you know, help me understand what my privacy will be if I use a 1% fabric versus a 5% fabric. And it depends on so many things. The fabric, the lighting inside the room, where people are standing in relation to the window and the light sources. So the very best way to ensure that the client feels comfortable with the amount of privacy is to provide them with a sample of the material and have them recreate this scenario at their home. Now, privacy and room darkening are needs that often go hand in hand. Now, on the left-hand side, we have a privacy fabric or a translucent fabric. And in general, the industry talks about these as fabrics that are at less than 1% of openness factor. We tend to avoid the word privacy, again, just because it is subjective, and we know that sometimes people might feel like even knowing that the lights are on means that they don't have privacy. So while there's very little openness there, as you can see in the picture, fabric might actually glow like frosted glass. A translucent fabric in a white material actually can brighten up the room and act like a light source. So this is actually a really good option when you have, let's say, a window that's looking into some sort of like light well, or if you have a neighbor that's very close, where we want to capture some of that brightness, still make sure that people can't see exactly what's going on inside. Now, a room darkening fabric may also be referred to as a blackout, and that's what you see on the right-hand side. Now, while blackout fabrics have a 0% openness, we want to be super careful about the expectation we're setting with the client. So no matter how opaque that fabric is, if light can come around the edges, we will not be creating a blackout environment. Think about a solid door, an interior door in your house. You can close that door. You know no light is coming through the door itself. We still can see light coming around the edges of that door, right? And so it's exactly the same with a blackout fabric shade. Now, what we have found after years and years of this is using the phrase blackout fabric can lead to misunderstandings with clients who are inexperienced at choosing window treatments. So make sure that when you're talking to your clients, you're really clear about, yes, this fabric says blackout and the fabric itself is blackout, but when we're not in side channels, we're going to get that light coming around the side. Okay, so let's say that you have the client, I call them vampire clients. It's crucial to them to sleep in the absolute darkness. You know, this is a electrical tape over the light on the cable box kind of client. So when you want to achieve blackout like that, remember that light is like water. If there is the tiniest opening, it will come through. So to achieve true blackout, there are kind of extreme steps that we want to take to keep that light out. We'll use recessed side channels with wool pile that the shade will travel through. That's what you see in this image here. The wool pile leans up against the shade fabric and stops the light from coming through. Now, up top, we may paint the interior of the pocket a matte black to prevent light from bouncing up behind the roller and over the top of the shade. We might use a exposed hem bar with a wool pile mustache, wool pile that runs along the very bottom of the hem bar so that when it drops down, ideally it drops down into a recess in the windowsill or tucks behind an L-shaped sill angle to stop light from creeping underneath. And that's how we would achieve what you see in this image here in this conference room where truly no light is coming through. Talk a little bit about VOCs. Now you may have heard of these. This is something that people in the industry have been talking about for a couple years. VOC stands for volatile organic compound. Now, these are organic chemicals that may give off molecules at room temperature. And guys, most sensor odors are VOCs. So, for example, the scent of a flower is made up of VOCs. So, I want to be clear that VOCs are not inherently bad. Now, wellness is a very important trend in design right now. So, many consumers are concerned about the potential for harmful VOCs. When talking about roller shades, it is very normal for new shades to give off a small amount of scent when first unrolled. You may hear that referred to as off-gassing. Now, there's no cause for concern with the small amount of off-gassing you'll experience with new PVC-coated solar fabrics. PVC is actually used all over the home in construction. It's just frequently in the time before the homeowner's there. Now, if these clients are particularly interested in reducing VOCs, that's great, and we have a way to identify what the right fabrics are for them, right? So you may want to consider a Green Guard certified fabric. That's the stamp that you see here on the screen, this green label. This is an independent organization that identifies materials with less off-gassing. You can feel really confident about using those materials in the home. And you have a nice range of options that fit the bill here. And then there are also PVC-free options to further reduce off-gassing if that's something that's important to your client. So in summary, there are just tons of fabric characteristics we can look to inform our decision on which fabric to specify. Often this means identifying top priorities and preferences in each space. So the ones that we talked through today, we talked a little bit about openness factor, right? Where a 0% fabric is a blackout and a 10% fabric is nice and sheer and is gonna let a ton of light in. We talked about color. Of course, your design preferences may be the priority and that's totally okay. But color also impacts our visibility through. We can see better through a dark fabric. It influences how much light we bring into the space. If we have a relatively dark room, we can use those lighter color fabrics to bring more light in and infuse our space with light. When we talk about weave, we're talking about a basket weave fabric for a lot of structure and performance and great visibility, or we might be looking to a knit fabric for a really soft hand. With composition, what's that fabric made of? Do we need the structural stability and, you know, flex resistance of fiberglass? Or do we want something like polyester that's a little more flexible? When it comes to acoustic performance, remember to check the data. Take a look for that NRC rating to find out how much that fabric is going to contribute to reducing reverberations in your space. For heat and UV, big takeaway, they work differently. We need to decide which one we want to prioritize so we can make the right choice. When it comes down to privacy, it's all subjective. That's the most important thing to keep in mind. And when it comes to privacy, mock-ups are key. So make sure to get a large fabric sample in the hands of your client so they can make sure they're comfortable. And environmental factors. How do we deal with humidity? How do we deal with when we want to reduce those harmful VOCs? These are all things to think about when you're choosing fabrics. So much more than just what's the color and what does it look like. So this concludes the CEU. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We hope this was really helpful to you. We want to let you know a little bit about resources we have available to help you find out this information and make decisions. We know it can be pretty overwhelming, right? So if you'd like more information on fabric composition, NRC rating, and all of those really important characteristics that we talked about today, please visit our fabric site, lutronfabrics.com. So on the site, you're able to navigate through our complete fabric collection, get super high res, way zoomed in images to really understand what these fabrics are like, and explore all of the technical data that we have available to really tell you about the fabric. You can also order free fabric samples at any time for your projects. So we definitely encourage you to use this resource. It is here for you guys. And you can also learn more about Lutron's luxury residential solutions on luxury.lutron.com. So thank you guys so much and have a great day.